How many love Jesus tonight? Amen. Yeah. Come on, shout like you love him tonight. Yeah. Come on, shout like you love him tonight. Yeah. Shout like you just came out of hell. God is awesome in this place.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Good to be home. Amen. You know, this is home. Come on. God is good. I have been just having a tremendous time this year. Been a fruitful year in the field. And you need to know that God has just been moving. Healings, deliverance, people getting set free, people getting blessed. And it is a tremendous privilege to say I am the New Hope Evangelist. Whoa. It blesses me. Come on, it blesses me to know that I represent you. And so every time I go, I let it go. And I represent you in Jesus' name. Amen. So I thank you for your prayers. I covet your prayers. And I pray God really help us these 3 nights in Jesus' name. Change the way we see life. Amen. Genesis chapter 1 tonight, if you have your Bibles. I love the theme of your conference. It's the year of testimonies. Yeah. The year of breakthroughs. Amen. The year of miracles. Amen. And we have no excuse. So we want to look at something that I believe is of God that you will never be able to say, I can't. You will never have an excuse after tonight. If you don't do it, it's because you simply don't want to. It's not because you can't. Because God is going to empower you tonight before you leave, and your life will never be the same. I love the theme. And in Revelations 12:11, it says, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. They overcame. Come on now. We're overcomers tonight. And we have no excuses not to overcome anything that comes against our lives. I want to minister this evening. God has increase on his mind. Genesis 1:26. You there say amen. And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over the cattle and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. And God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And God blessed them. And God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply, and replenish the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. Amen. From the beginning of time, when God created man in his own image, God had increase on his mind. And when God created the garden, he wanted someone to take care of what he had created. Someone that could continue creating. And so God, the Bible says, blessed Adam and his wife and gave them the power to do what he did in the garden. The Bible says he blessed them. And he told them to be fruitful and to multiply, to replenish the earth, to subdue it, and to have dominion. It's a fivefold blessing, which really demonstrates the hand of God. And when the hand of God is on you, you have no excuse.
Come on.
Because if God be for you, who can be against you?
Come on.
You know, someone said, if your family's not saved, I don't know if they were going to say, if you're not saved, but I'll tell you what, if you're not saved, you don't know what you're missing. And if you're saved, I pray tonight, you'll understand who you really are in God. And you'll start living in the authority of a believer that you've called to walk in and to walk in victory. You have no excuse to be living the life God's called you to live. And I pray that these days of fasting that you sacrificed, that you're willing tonight to really receive the word of God with gladness. And so I want to challenge you tonight before I go any further, to make a concrete decision in your mind tonight that you're going to believe what's being preached tonight. You're going to believe it without hesitation because it is the word of God. And the word of God never returns back void. It'll always do that which is purposed to do. And we want to make a clear distinction between the blessing of the Lord and the blessings of the Lord. The Bible does not say that he gave them blessings. The Bible says he blessed them. The Bible says he blessed them. We live in a time where Christians get saved for the blessings. They're looking for the blessings. You have to understand tonight before you leave that if God blesses you, you don't ever have to worry about the blessings. They'll come looking for you.
Come on.
Because you are blessed of God, and they have no choice in the matter than to come and to rest upon your life. Because the Bible declares a faithful man shall abound with blessings. A faithful woman shall abound with blessings. The women got to shout tonight.
Woo!
You see, all you have to do is be faithful. Can you say amen?
Yes.
And God will begin to bless your life.
Thank you, Jesus.
As we see Abel's life, and I couldn't help but sit there thinking when I met him a year ago. A year ago, exactly, when I came for the last revival. And they were going to bring a basket to my room, and the room wasn't ready yet, so I was waiting in the lobby, and I busted them trying to come in. And I met him there that day, and we were able to share Christ with him a little bit and try and just pray that he would stay saved. That he would not be another statistic of the Rasa that dies in their sins or rots in a prison cell. It's not a joke. It's not something, you know, that we just say is a cliche, you know, I thank God I'm not dead or locked up. How many know it's true?
Yeah.
Most of us are here because we simply didn't get caught. Don't get holy now. We're all guilty of something now. But see, God has a plan for our lives. It's a plan of victory and blessings. Come on, somebody. And we have to come to a deep-rooted understanding that when God blessed man in the beginning, he gave him the blessing. He gave him the power. Because when you get blessed by God, you have power tonight. I said, you have power. Because it's a fivefold blessing. When you have God's blessing upon your life, it will cause you to be fruitful. You have no choice in the matter. Your life will be blessed. You will be fruitful. Everything you touch will prosper in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
When you have his blessing upon your life, he will cause you to multiply.
Yes.
Or you'll be blessed in Jesus' name. You'll have more than enough, praise God. When you are blessed of God, the blessing will cause you to replenish.
Yes.
It'll cause you to replenish. Replenish means to stock with abundance, to renew or to supply. In other words, you ain't never going to run out. Because you are blessed of God, and it's the divine will of God that you have more than enough.
Yes.
Come on.
Thank you, Jesus.
We don't serve a God that wants us to live in a city called just getting by. He don't want us living in the land of just enough. He wants us in a land that's flowing with milk and honey.
Yeah.
If it's got honey, you might as well throw in some ribs. Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah.
But when you're blessed, it will cause you, can you say amen?
Amen.
To replenish. Every time my wife asks me to go to the store, I come back, she gets mad. We needed sodas and water. Why did you bring 5 cases of soda and 5 cases of water? So we don't run out. Well, I don't have to go back. Come on, somebody. So when I look in my kitchen and I see stacks, come on now. I don't see soda. I don't see water. I see abundance. I see abundance. And see, we live in a world where people have gotten the word of God twisted because of perverted preachers that have done bad things with the money. Come on now. And run off with the secretary. Come on, somebody. I tell Pastor, you're going to get a secretary? Get an ugly woman, praise God. What do you want to run off with? Thank you, Jesus. Must have. The vicious dog breath. Come on, man. But God wants us to be blessed. You know, people give me numbers for pastors and they'll say, hey, so tell me about your ministry. I've never met them. And I tell them, well, I flow in 2 things. Healing of hearts and minds and healing of money. What do you mean? I can't explain it to you. All I can tell you is when I open the altar, they don't have a choice because God's hand is on me. They're going to begin to cry whether they like it or not. Because they're going to get healed whether they like it or not. Because healing power is here.
And if they dare give, God's going to bless them above and beyond, going to blow their mind.
Come on.
Because God, amen, blesses those that give. They say, well, you know, we don't want you coming here and talking about T.D. Jakes or Creflo Dollar. I go, why would I mention them? I'm preaching Jesus.
Yes.
I'm preaching the Word of God. Yes. I don't know what they think or what they know. What they do is none of my business, and nor am I judging their ministry. But I know what my Bible says. The thief cometh but to kill, steal, and destroy. But Jesus said, I've come that they might have abundance.
Yes. Yes.
How can you quote only the first half and not the rest? Don't you want abundance? What's wrong with you? So I tell them, well, if you don't want me to come, then keep your people sick and broke. But if you want them blessed, come on, somebody, I'm your man.
Yeah.
Now, you got to hear me tonight, because what's happening to me this year, every year I pray for God to speak to me that I can speak to you.
Yes.
Give me revelation so I can give revelation to you.
Amen.
And so my cry this year was, Lord, show me what you want your church to understand, that they might come to a deeper level of understanding with you.
Yes.
And God gave me this word. Can you say amen?
Amen?
Gave me revelation. I've been saved 36 years. Didn't know I was flowing in it already. Some of you are flowing in it already, but you didn't know why. Tonight you're going to leave knowing why you're so blessed. You're blessed because God's hand is upon you. You're blessed because He's blessed your life. Come on, somebody. And He's caused you to be fruitful. He will cause you to multiply. He'll cause you to replenish. Come on, somebody. She'll get mad because I bring the soda, the water, and then even worse, she'll get more mad because I bring 30 rolls of toilet paper. The economy pack. And she says, what's with the paper? Were you traumatized as a kid? And I go, no, but I don't want to be traumatized as an adult. I sure don't want to go where there ain't no paper. I got to use one of Nico's comic books. I gotta walk around with Sonic the Hedgehog on my butt. I don't think so. I'm too blessed for that. And I don't see it as exaggerated. I see it as just abundance. Just abundance. Come on now. Every time I buy, body wash and shampoo, I buy 10, 12 bottles at a time. And it's always full. And I'm understanding the reason it's there. It's not because I'm afraid of running out and I've been traumatized. It's that that's just what God has caused me to live in. Because He's blessed me. So He's caused me to live in abundance. Can you say amen? He's caused me to live a life that has more than enough. Philippians says, but my God shall supply all your needs. Come on now. According to His riches in glory. Why? Because He loves you. And because He loves you, He's blessed your life. And you have to learn to accept it tonight, that you do have no excuse not to be fruitful anymore. You have no excuse not to be multiplying anymore. You have no excuse to have the replenishing happening in your life. You should have more than enough.
Amen.
When you're blessed, it causes you to have the power to subdue. Subdue means to bear down or to break down, to break, to conquer, to control, to crush, and to defeat.
Amen.
When you are blessed of God, it causes you to live in victory.
Yes.
We want breakthroughs, and some of us have come to the place that we think, I hope I get a breakthrough in this revival. You can get a breakthrough by yourself.
Come on.
All you need is faith. Can you say amen? All you need is to learn how to cry out to God. And I'll say it again. This is what God wants to do with me this year. And I've been just seeking God. And God says, you know why my people struggle? Because they don't have enough faith. And we need to raise their level of faith so they understand that I am still alive. That I am still alive. And that there's power in the name of Jesus. Let them know that they have my name to walk in. They've got the name of Jesus tonight. They've got my blood to plead over their family. We've got the name of Jesus. We've got the blood of Jesus. And we're going to have His blessing tonight in Jesus' name. Before you leave, we're going to pronounce a blessing of God over your life. Your life is going to change. Because the blessing is going to cause you to be fruitful. It's going to cause you to multiply. It's going to cause you to subdue. It'll cause you to have dominion. Come on now.
Yes, thank you, Jesus.
Dominion means to dominate, to control, to command, to have authority and to rule. Some of you, this year, you don't even know, but this is your year for promotion. Amen. This is your year to be the supervisor. This is your year to be the manager. Come on, somebody. That people that are dogging you, they don't know what's coming. There's going to be a new sheriff in town, thank you, Jesus. See, God's in the blessing business. This is the year of promotion. This is the year of increase. This is the year of breakthroughs and miracles. You just got to get your faith together and trust God and believe, amen, and begin to speak. Know who you are in God tonight. Psalms 8, 4 through 6 says, what is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou would visit him? For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels, and hast crowned him with glory and honor. Thou hast made him to have dominion over the works of thy hands, and thou hast put all things under his feet. We are kings and priests. Can you say amen?
Amen.
We're not just anybody. We're children of the Most High God.
Yeah.
We are king. Come on, king's kids tonight. We are royalty. Come on, somebody. We are blessed tonight. We're not called to be conquerors. We're called to be more than conquerors tonight. Why are we struggling? You ask people, what are you doing? How are you doing? I'm doing okay under the circumstances. We say, what are you doing under there? Because my Bible says we're always above and never beneath. Blessed coming in and blessed going out. The head and not the tail. Come on, somebody. Blessed. Blessed. Blessed in the field. Blessed wherever we go. Because that's the will of God for our lives. But you know what happens when the trials come? We forget who we are in God.
Yeah.
We forget it because sometimes we make mistakes. We forget that God loves us enough to forgive us and pick us up again. Amen. And that his promises are true. Yes. That he's a covenant God. Come on, somebody. Yes. See, God made a covenant with Adam. And God blessed him. And even though he blessed him and gave him the power to be fruitful, gave him the power to multiply, gave him the power to subdue, gave him all that power, he still in disobedience lost the blessing in the garden. It's called the Eden blessing. And he lost it in the Garden of Eden. And God kicked him out and the blessing stayed in the garden. But because God is a God of mercy, he found a way to continue the blessing to flow. And so God brings a flood upon humanity. But God, the Bible says, touches Noah, and he finds grace in the eyes of God, spares only him and his family. And the Bible says that after the flood succeeds, and it's all over, that they open the door to the ark, and they look out, him and his sons. And the Bible says, and God blessed Noah and his sons, and said unto them, be fruitful and multiply, and replenish the earth. In other words, I'm blessing you, God says. But you have to grab this tonight. When they opened the door to the ark, they did not look out and see green grass. They did not see flowers. They did not see life. They stepped out into death. Everything that had breath had died in that flood. There was a stench in the air of death. Bodies laying everywhere. Animals that were dead. It stunk so bad. But he stepped out into nothing. But out of nothing came something. Because God had blessed him. And God had given him the power to be fruitful, to multiply, to replenish. Oh, you ain't hearing me tonight. See, God blessed him. He stepped into nothing, but something came from nothing. You may be here tonight and you ain't got nothing, but you're about to get something in Jesus' name. Oh, you may walk in tonight with nothing, but you're going to walk out with something in the name of Jesus. Oh, I'm telling you, God infused Noah with the power of God. He went out there and had creative power and began to do what God had done in the garden, and he began to be fruitful and to multiply. In Genesis 26, 12, the Bible says, Isaac, that there's a famine in the land. If you read Genesis 26, 1, the Bible says there's a double famine. But in Genesis 26, 12, then Isaac sowed in that land and received in the same year 100-fold. Why? Because the Lord blessed him. Because the Lord blessed him. It doesn't say because God pronounced blessings plural, blessing, singular. We don't have to worry about the blessings. They'll take care of themselves. You just make sure you're blessed tonight. Because if you're blessed, the blessings will follow you wherever you go. Come on, somebody. I said, wherever you go, the blessings will follow you. Come on now. I bought Nico a phone, a new phone for his birthday. His birthday's Thursday. So I walked into T-Mobile to get him a brand new phone, and I don't know anything about phones. Come on now. I just walked in there and said, look, man, I need a phone for my son. I don't know what I'm doing, don't know anything, but I'm trusting you not to burn me. Come on now. And I was praying while I was talking. Come on. And I said, Lord, you called me to be blessed. So touch him and let him bless me. So he says, well, I want the best phone you got. Unlimited everything. Because you know how they are. He says, I have this one. I go, what's the difference? He goes, well, this one's actually, you know, this one just came in this week. That's the best we got right now. I said, what's it cost me to walk out with it? He says, $100. And I said, And he says, you know what? I don't want you to walk out, so I'm going to give you a case for his phone. I'm going to throw in some headphones, car charger. And there was a speaker right there that was $65. And I said, I'm thinking, but I'm also looking at the speaker. See, you have to know something. I didn't walk in there with $20 to buy a phone. I walked in ready to buy a phone. I had money. Come on, somebody.
Come on.
And so I said, I like that speaker, though. He goes, I don't even work here, man. We just stopped by. We're on our way to Lancaster. So I'll be there this weekend. Go right on. And I didn't tell him I was preaching. I just said, I'll be there this weekend. And then he says, look, man, take the phone for $100. I'll give you that $65 speaker for $25. I said, write it up. I'll pay you cash. He says, dude, you scored. I go, I'm blessed. As soon as I say that, there's a guy that holds a sign at the corner, which is 2 blocks from my house. He goes to a church I preach at. His name is Joe. He knows me and Nico. He walks in the door right as he tells me, man, you scored. I said, no, I didn't score. I got blessed. This guy says, hey, pastor. And the guy goes, you a pastor? I go, yes, I am. He said, well, no wonder you're blessed. Well, come on now. No wonder you're blessed. So much, because when you're blessed, come on now, it's not the blessings. The blessings will follow you. Quit tripping on the blessings already.
Come on.
Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Everything you need, everything you want, it'll just come to you. Come on, somebody.
It'll
just come to you. Why? Because you're blessed. Proverbs 10:22 says, the blessing of the Lord, it make it rich and adds no sorrow. Yes. Listen, church, please hear the Holy Ghost tonight. It does not say the blessings of the Lord. That scripture's not plural, it's singular. The blessing of the Lord make it rich and adds sorrow. And on that note, you gotta quit being afraid of being rich. Some of you got to quit being afraid of being rich and quit being afraid of big money. Come on now. Because God's about to bless God's people this year. There's going to be a transfer of money this year into God's people's hands. I know what I'm telling you. And God's about to bless you. Matter of fact, pray for me. I've been preaching for baby churches. I preach for a brand new baby church, a new destiny in San Bernardino. Pastor Sean.
Yes, come on.
When I preach for him, I was praying before the service, and God said, I don't want you to take any money from him. And I said, all right. He says, but what I want you to do is I want you to pray, and I want you to hear from heaven, and I'm going to give you some sponsors, and they're going to start giving you money this year. So I said, okay. So he went to bless me, and I said, brother, we're good. Don't trip. It's fine. He goes, don't worry about it. God's going to take care of me. And so I'll be meeting this week, I pray, with a buddy of mine who has his own business. And this past year, Every 3 months, he would give me $500 cash for my ministry. But I'm praying for God to touch him to give me one check for the year with a lot of zeros. Come on now. You know how like the song said, oh, oh, oh? I want them O's on that check. I want that check to say, oh, oh, oh. But how can God bless you big when you ask for small? Yes. How can he bless you big when you have a small mind? You wonder how we think because we serve a big God. We say we serve a big God, but we ask for little things. Ask for big things, can you say amen?
Amen.
Ask for big things. And quit tripping on the enemy already.
Come on.
Bible says there are many adversaries. But there's also an effectual door. You know, we spend more time looking for the adversaries instead of the door that's already open.
Come on.
Are you hearing me?
Amen.
The enemy is under our feet.
Yeah.
I have so many pictures on my phone that I love, and I'll use one right now, where it says, God will put your enemies under your feet. He'll make them a footstool. I have a picture of a Christian brother sitting in a chair. It's not a recliner. He needs what's called an ottoman so he can extend his feet. He couldn't find one. So he grabbed his Bible, he grabbed his coffee, and he commanded the devil to get on his knees before him. And he's got his legs on the devil's back. Come on, somebody. And the devil's looking at him mad. I said, the devil's looking at him mad. Out of the chompa. But the Christian brother don't care about that look. He's too blessed to be stressed. He's got his legs on his foot, he's drinking his coffee and reading his Bible. And the scripture says, I'll make your enemies a footstool. Oh, come on now. Devil cannot have victory in our lives. I don't know why we worry. No weapon formed against us will ever prosper. If the enemy comes in one way, he will flee seven different ways. What does that mean? Well, we just finished with Christmas. If you throw a child an ornament, it comes in one piece. But if he hits it with a stick, it'll explode and go all over the place. That's what God said. That's what I'll do to your enemy when he comes against you. I will crush him. I will crush him. But we live in fear. We live a life of fear, and we don't allow the scriptures to sink in. Come on now. In Numbers 23, you find the story where, you know, a king tries to convince a prophet of God to curse Israel. And he pays him. And he stands on the mountaintop. And the Bible says, he opens his mouth, and the king wants him to curse God's people. And he says, how can I curse whom God had not cursed? How can I defy whom the Lord had not defied? And the king gets mad and says, what are you saying? I paid you to curse him. And he said, I can't curse whom God has blessed. Why do you worry about it? Come on now. Oh, I think she might have put a spell on me. Shut up with your stupid spells already. You have no power over me.
Whoa.
I said, you have no power over me. I'm covered in the blood of Jesus. Oh, man, I'm walking in power and authority. Demons tremble when we walk. Come on, somebody. And if hell don't know your name, shame on you. Hell has to know your name. Hell has to tremble at your name. Come on now. See, we have to come to the place where we understand the devil can't curse us. In the same story, he did do it three times. And he says, behold, I have received a commandment to bless, and he has blessed, and I cannot reverse it. It's irrevocable. God has blessed you. God has blessed you already. Why are you looking for the blessings when you're already blessed? Yes. Just serve God. Yes. Just be faithful. Yes. Throw yourself into the ministry. Throw yourself into God's arms. Yes. Fall in love with God. Yes. Come on, get excited about the Lord.
Yes.
Stop going. You know what I see this year that I didn't see last year? Last year I saw people struggling to go to church. This year I see people coming to church.
Come on.
I preached this Thursday night. Actually, Wednesday night I preached. And when I got there, the people were there before the pastor. And the pastor goes, wow, they must be hungry. They beat me to church. Come on, somebody.
Come on.
See, people are getting hungry in these last days. Because people have had enough already. It's time to get back what the devil stole from us. It's time for us to be blessed. And quit hoping that we'll be blessed and be blessed already. Can you say amen? Isaiah 44:3 says, "For I will pour water upon him that is thirsty and floods upon dry ground. And I will pour my spirit upon thy seed and my blessing, not my blessings, but my blessing upon thine offspring." Come on now. God wants your children blessed. Look at Abel. He's blessed because his mom's blessed. He's not blessed by chance. Let's keep it real. He had no choice in the matter. Because the Bible says, "Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and your entire household shall be saved." So I don't care what he thought he was going to do in his life. It's over. Come on. God already had him. And he wasn't going to get away. And you see the spirit that's in him now, he ain't never going to backslide. He loves God too much. He's thankful for his salvation. But see, that's what the scripture says. I'll pour my blessing upon your seed. My daughter graduated from college about six weeks ago. Her last day was on a Thursday. She got a degree in business administration. I didn't know this until afterwards, but she says, "Dad, you know, that last week, I actually was starting to worry because I didn't have a job waiting for me." She was working at the college, correcting papers. And she said, "Dad, I didn't know what I was going to do. I don't even know how to look for a job. They gave me the job here at the school, but I don't know how to look for a job." Don't worry. Good. Don't worry. I got you covered. Mom and Dad, you don't understand how bad your kids need you.
Yes.
You don't know how much they need you to pray and to say, "I got you."
Come on.
You watch God move. Come on now. Yes. So her last day is on a Thursday, and on Monday she starts a brand new job. Oh, come on now. 3 miles from home. I take him to school. I take her to work. We pray in the morning. The minute I drop them off, I go home and pray. And she got hired during the holidays, and so she worked. She was off the Monday for Christmas, off the Monday for New Year's. And the lady that does the accounting says, "Oh, I want you to know that because you haven't finished your 90-day probation, you won't be getting paid for the 2 days." And my daughter said, "That's fine." And so my daughter says, "Yeah, Dad, they told me they're not going to pay me." And I said, "Are they going to pay you?" Huh? I said, "They're going to pay you." "Ooh, well, Dad," she said. I go, "I know what she said. I heard you clear. But I'm telling you what he said. He told me to tell you that because I'm blessed, you're going to get blessed. And then you're going to bless me." Do I have to tell you in Jesus' name, she got paid for both days? Huh? Oh, yeah. She got paid. And then 2 weeks ago, my wife wakes me up and says, "You're going to have to take Alicia to the doctor. She can't breathe." So I take her to the hospital at 4 in the morning, praying all the way there. No traffic. We walk to the hospital, not a person there. They take her right away. Come on now. They take her in right away. And they say, "We think she might have asthma. She might have bronchitis. We're going to keep her overnight." So they keep her overnight. They do all these x-rays. And I go, and she can't breathe. She can't breathe without air. She's having a tough time. And listen, you'll never advance without adversity, my friend.
Come on.
You think you want to go farther with God, you better get ready for the battle.
Come on.
And so the devil tries to come against her, but no weapon will prosper.
Yes.
So there she is. She's struggling. See, she's struggling. And I'm praying. I'm trusting God. I drop Nico off, and I go straight to the hospital every morning. Come on now. And I'm there with her, praying with her, trusting God. And then on the third day, I go in there in the morning, and she's crying. And I go, "What's the matter, honey?" She says, "Dad, a nurse came in, and I asked her, and I knew she should have answered me, but I asked her, 'Have they seen my x-rays?' And she said, 'Yes, they have.' And did they come out?" He says, "No, it came out negative. You have lung cancer." So my daughter goes, "Wow." And she says, "Dad," she tells me, and she walks away and leaves me there. "You're not here. Mom's not here. I don't know what to do, Dad. But let me show you the power of our DNA that we have when we're praying, moms and dads and grandparents."
Okay.
My dad went to be with the Lord 12 years ago. And when they told him, Mr. Menchaca, you have 6 months to live. We can't even count the cancer cells in your body anymore. You've got 6 months to live. And my dad said, says who? Well, you know, says all the bad. Well, you're not my creator. You don't tell me when to go home. You didn't create me. I'll go home when he tells me to come home. Because I have an appointed time. And so do you. And I'm thinking I might outlive you. My dad lived 6 years. So my daughter says, Dad, when they told me that, fear kicked in. But I remember the story you told me about the picture on your phone that says a woman goes to her closet in the morning and she's got two blouses. On the one on the right says faith and the one on the left says fear. And she's got her hand on the one that says faith. And what she's saying is, today I have a choice to put faith on or put fear on. I'm going to put faith on today. Oh, you ain't hearing me. I'm going to put on faith today. I have a choice to put faith or fear on, but I'm going to put on faith. She said, Dad, I put my faith on, and I said, I do not have cancer in Jesus' name. Amen. Oh, no, I don't in Jesus' name. We never heard another word about cancer, nothing. All of a sudden, about 3 hours later, my daughter said, Dad, I got to go to the bathroom. But I'm going to unplug my air. I think I can make it in time to there and come back. So she unplugs her nose and she goes and she comes back. And just getting ready to sit down, the nurse walks in and says, did you just come out of the bathroom? And my daughter says, yes. She says, without your air? She said, yeah. She says, let me check the air in your body. They put this thing on your finger. And when my daughter went in, she was at 72. You got to be at 90 or above. She says, you're at 94.
Woo, come on.
You know what? I'm going to come back in 10 minutes. Just sit down. Don't breathe heavy. I'm going to come back in 10 minutes and test you again. She comes back in 20, and she checks my daughter, and she says, you're at 96. You're climbing. You want to go home? My daughter says, yes. I said, when can she go home? She says, she'll go home in an hour. I said, let's go. So she went home. Come on now. Breathing on her own. Heal by the grace of God. She called her job, text them, send them pictures of her in the hospital. They said, you don't have to send us pictures. We trust you. She said, but it's my first job. I don't want to lose this. You ain't never going to lose this job.
Yeah.
We like you here.
Woo.
You ain't hearing me. So I tell my daughter, now we're praying that you get paid for being in the hospital. They don't know it, but they're going to pay you in Jesus' name.
Come on.
So I take her to work today, and I meet her boss. And he says, oh, this is my dad. Dad, this is DJ. And I go, hey, what's up? And we start talking. And I look at his keychain, and he's got a Colts chain on his keys. And I'm a Colts fan, so I go, you're a Colts fan? He goes, yeah. I go, so am I. He goes, yeah, my dad's brother played for the Colts. And I go, man, I've been a Colts fan since I was in junior high. When I was in junior high, they told me, go do a book report. I said, book report? Your mama do a book report. They said, but you can do it on anything you want. I said, oh, man. So I went to the sports section, and I found a book called The Player Nobody Ever Wanted by Johnny Unitas. He played for the Baltimore Colts. And I said, I read that book. I did my thing, and I got an A. Come on now. And I've been a Colts fan ever since. So we start talking. He goes, man, you know, you got a good daughter. I go, yeah, she's a fighter. She's a fighter, and she's going to be a blessing to you. Come on now. And I have a jersey, a Colts jersey. He don't know, but I'm going to give it to him Monday. Come on now.
Come on.
Oh, come on now. You got to put some bread on that butter every now and then. You hear me? You feel me?
Yeah,
come on now. I smell a raise, praise
yeah.
God. Devil can't curse where God is called blessed. My brother Luke was a pastor. Was on the job for 28 years. He calls me up about 6 months ago and says, hey, bro, you're not going to believe it. I went and he goes, they just laid me off. I said, good for you. Why? I go, good for you. God has plans for you.
Amen.
Yeah, but you don't understand. I can't collect my Social Security because I'm not 62. I go, Beto, you've been giving for 36 years. You have a bank account in heaven, my brother.
Yes.
Huh?
Come on.
God already rebuked the devourer.
Yes,
just relax and trust in the Lord.
Yes.
And watch God bless you. So he goes to church and he shares it with a couple in the church. They go, my daughter works for Social Security. You don't even have to go. We'll come to your house with a laptop and do it all for you. So they went and did everything, and the girl says, well, you know, Mr. Menchaca, she says, you know, you don't qualify for Social Security yet, but you do qualify for unemployment for 6 months. He says, that's great, because in 6 months, I'll be 62. And she said, do you want EBT and food stamps? And he said, you know, when you work, you in your mind, you think, I don't want that. Come on now. I'm a worker. He goes, sure, I'll take it. So he calls me like a little kid, like he stole something. Hey, bro, check it out. I'm at KFC. They take EBT. I said, well, bring me a bucket, baby. What you talking about? Don't forget the biscuits. Come on now, Mama Biscuit. Bring me the biscuit. So I tell Nico, hey, you feel that? The man is all excited because he's got his EBT. And because we're a working family and we teach him, we ain't a welfare family.
Come on.
Come on, somebody. I ain't got nothing against it if you need it. But I got a lot against it if you're in this house lifting your hands and praising God and you're lying.
Come on.
You don't know where your old man is, but every 9 months you're pregnant. Come on now. But that's a different sermon. I tell Nico, you feel all excited because you got EBT. And he goes, Dad, isn't that for poor people? And I go, no, it's for people that are between jobs. It was never meant to be a lifestyle. It was just for people that are struggling, and your theoretical is between jobs, so he's taking it. Come on now. And food stamps. I told him, brother, carne asada, what are you thinking? What is there to talk about? How much did they give you? $180? $180 in carne, baby. Let's get it on. It's called abundance. Can you say amen? Are you hearing me tonight? See, when God blesses you, no weapon formed against you will prosper. Stop getting, be moved. Come on, somebody. Let it come. I don't care what comes, man. God is with me. If God before me, who can be against me? Galatians 3:13, let me hurry, says, Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham, that the blessing, not the blessings, but that the blessing of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Through faith, through faith, through faith. If you got the faith to believe tonight, we're going to pronounce a blessing over you. And if you got the faith to say, I receive it, your life is going to change forever. I said forever. I said forever. I said forever. Man, all of a sudden things are going to begin to flourish around you. Come on, somebody. All of a sudden you're going to get promoted. You're going to get a raise.
Come
on. Scratching your head already. I wonder what's going on. Charlie, I know what's going on. I'm blessed of God. And he's blessing me. Can you say amen?
Amen.
You say, well, I've never really understood the blessing of Abraham. What is it? Well, Genesis 22:17 says to Abraham that God says that in blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying I will multiply thy seed as the stars of the heaven, and as the sand which is upon the seashore, and thy seed shall possess the gates of thine enemies. God is about to bring multiplication to this church.
Hallelujah!
Are you ready to shout tonight? I praise God for the love that's in this house. But you better get ready for new people. You better get ready for new people, and you need to love them the way you love each other right now.
Amen.
I'm telling you, because God's about to take this church to a new dimension. If you don't think for one moment God isn't faithful to people that cry out, you lost your mind. God is faithful. And God told me to tell your pastor and you as a church, your faithfulness is about to pay off. And we have no excuse. Come on, somebody. The Bible says in the book of Acts, when the church first started, that God added to the church daily those that should be saved. But in Acts chapter 6, it says that God began to multiply the church. They went from addition to multiplication. God has been adding. You're about to shift into multiplication, and it's going to get crazy up in here.
Yeah.
I said it's going to get crazy up in here.
Yeah.
But we have to be ready and want to go to the next level. Can you say amen?
Yes.
Quit settling already.
Come on.
Stop settling for where you are.
Yes.
Start dreaming again. Can you say amen?
Yeah.
You know what happens? We say, how you doing, brother? I'm doing good. Well, good. I'm glad for you. But you know what? Good will always be an enemy of better. And better says, hey, bro, come on over here. Good says, why would you want to mess up a good thing? Stay right here. Don't rock the boat. And better says, come on, man. Don't you want something better?
Come on.
So you say, I'll see you around, good. It was fun knowing you, but I got to go. So you go to better and you're happy, man. How you doing? I'm doing better than I was doing last year. And you're happy, you're excited, you're flourishing. All of a sudden, you hear somebody calling you. His name is Best.
Come on.
And Best says, what's going on, brother? Oh, man, I'm doing better. He goes, yeah, but don't you want the best? And better will always be an enemy of best. And if we're not careful, we'll settle for where we are. I talked about that this Thursday night in a church about wanting more. Afterwards, the pastor came to me in tears and said, Pastor, can I talk to you? And I said, sure. He said, you know what? My dad had a brother. It was a bigger brother. And when they were born on a farm. They grew up on a farm. And my uncle always had the bigger pig, and my dad had the smaller pig. My uncle always had the bigger garden, and my dad the smaller garden. He began to get teary. He said, you know, and then my dad went into the Navy. And he says, but my uncle went to college first and got a degree and went into the Navy as an officer. Then when he got out, he landed a job in Boston and he's really doing well. My dad got out, he got a job as a steel worker. And it seems everything you were preaching tonight really defined that my dad was always happy and satisfied with just doing good. He never wanted to do better. And I've come to tell you tonight, God wants you to do better.
Come on.
And we have no excuse. You have a pastor who loves you. The power of God is in this place. Miracles are happening. Your lives are being changed. You're going to be infused with power right now. You have no excuse. Yes. I told you make a decision to believe. Can you say amen? 2 Chronicles 20:20 says, believe in the Lord your God, so shall you be established. Believe in his prophets, so shall you prosper.
Amen.
Your life is going to prosper.
Amen.
I said, your life is going to prosper.
Hallelujah.
Come on, there's people that are in this church tonight. They're not going to testify right now. But they can tell you that they were there when I took up an offering and they gave it, how God blessed their lives.
Yeah.
And they can testify. It ain't no game. It ain't no joke. It's real.
Yeah.
And you step out in faith, God will bless you. Can you say amen?
Yeah.
Genesis 1:27. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female, he created them. Look at me tonight. This is not the image of God. Come on, somebody. God don't look like me. Huh. Don't look like Buggy and Buddha all in one. That ain't what God looks like. What God looks like is what's on the inside of me.
Come on, yes.
What God looks like is what's on the inside of you.
Yes.
And the man and the woman that's inside of you is striving to come out. Is striving to kill that old man so it can relive in that blessing that God has declared for us to live in. And we're screaming to get out. That's what this fast was all about. To touch God. To get closer to God. To pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. That's enough singing that song already. Start living it.
Come on.
Pull heaven down.
Yes.
Pull heaven down.
Yes.
Pull heaven down.
Yes.
Pull it down into your situation. Thy kingdom come. Ain't no poverty in heaven. Ain't no sickness in heaven. Ain't no lack in heaven. Pull heaven down in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And believe God for greater things. Can you say amen? Colossians 3 said, and put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. Put on the new man. Can you say amen? You're not going to be blessed unless you die to self. You can't be blessed. Romans 12:2 says, don't copy the behavior and the customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. It's time to change the way we think. Can you say amen? Stop thinking small already. When you get a bad report, stop receiving it. Start getting a little Pentecostal, old school. Come on, somebody. And say, I'll rebuke that in the name of Jesus. Come on, somebody. I don't receive that. I don't care what you say. I won't believe the report of the Lord. Come on, somebody. I serve a God that can turn anything around. You tell me you got the final say. My God has the final say. And you start pressing into that old man, that new man, all of a sudden you begin to rise up. Can you say amen? Change the way you think. Philippians 2:5 says, let this mind be in you which was in Christ. So tonight you say, well, Pastor, what's on the mind of God tonight? Well, Psalms 115:12 says, the Lord has been mindful of us. He will bless us. What's God thinking about right now as I'm preaching? He's thinking about how he's going to bless you at this altar tonight.
Yes.
How he's going to give you revelation. How he's going to infuse you with power. Come on now. To give you the power to be fruitful. To give you the power to multiply. To give you the power. Come on now. For whatever situation in your life, you have the power.
And you have no excuse not to be victorious anymore. I love this theme. It's tremendous. It needs to be screamed on the mountaintops. We have no excuse.
Yes, amen.
Christians have even taken back the government.
Come on. Yes.
You ain't shouting.
Oh, yes.
We've even taken back the government. And we're rising up. Can you say amen?
Oh.
Christians finally came out of the closet. Woo. Praise God.
Come on.
And God is back in the White House.
Yes.
He's there in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And they're standing against abortion. They're standing against gay rights.
Amen.
And it's making people mad.
Come on.
And if you really look at that and analyze it, which I haven't done because I've been locked in the church for so long, I never realized how perverted this nation is.
Come on.
And how much they hate God and how much they hate you and me and how much they hate everything we stand for. But there is a God in heaven.
Yes.
Come on.
There is a God in heaven.
Oh,
yeah. He's going to give us the victory. And we stand for God. Can you say amen?
Amen.
We got to stop looking at our problems and start looking to God. Put on the new man. Renew your mind. Quit looking through your normal eyes and look through God's eyes.
Yes.
In 1 Kings 6, you find the story where the king is angry because every time he tries to attack Israel, someone gives him a warning and he finds out it's Elisha. So he goes to kill Elisha. They surround his house. And then his young disciple goes outside and comes and says, "Oh, master, we're surrounded. They're going to kill us." He's full of fear. Elijah says, "Relax, man. Don't you know that if God be for us, who can be against us?" And the Bible says that Elijah prayed and said, "Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes that he may see." And the Lord opened his eyes and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire round about Elijah. Open his eyes. He had physical eyes. He could see. He could see the army. He could see what surrounded. All he could see was fear and death. But when God opened his eyes and he began to see through the eyes of God, he said, "Oh, I got nothing to worry about." You have nothing to worry about tonight. I said, you have nothing to worry about.
Yes, amen.
Oh, I'm telling you, an evangelist, I am, my mind is blown how much people worry. How the altars are packed with people that are just afraid of what's going on in their life. Like they don't know. I don't think they do. That if you're saved, God has blessed your life. And because he's blessed you, listen, we're not talking about the blessings. The blessings are going to come and go. Come on, somebody. Later with that. But when the blessing comes upon you, you have the power to be fruitful. You have the power to multiply. You have the power to replenish. You have the power to subdue. And you have the power to have dominion.
Amen.
That covers everything in life that will ever come against your life. You have the victory.
Amen.
And you have no excuse not to be victorious.
Amen.
Job 8:7 says, "Though thy beginning was small, yet thy latter end shall greatly increase." Come on now. The Living Translation says, "And though you started with little, you will end with much."
Yeah.
Another translation says, "Though your beginning was small, your latter days will be very great." Come on now. It's up to you to decide and say, "I want to be very great. I want to end with much. And I want increase." Come on, somebody.
Yeah.
This is a year of increase. This is a year of blessings. This is a year of breakthrough. But you've got to tap into your faith tonight. Can you say amen?
Yeah.
And believe God. Believe what's being preached tonight and leave tonight in awe of God. Leave knowing that God gave you revelation and now you understand. I'm not looking for the blessings ever again. They're going to look for me because I'm blessed.
Yes.
They're going to come looking for me. Come on now. I went in to buy a phone and walked out with a bunch of stuff. Why? Because it's following me. And people still don't get it. I'll go to a restaurant and it's empty. And I sit down. The minute I sit down, it gets packed. And the person with me who's immature says, "Well, we came right on time. We beat the crowd." I go, "We didn't beat the crowd. We brought the crowd."
Yeah.
You get it? Wherever we go, the blessings follow. I went to get my car washed. And I tell the girl, "How's business?" She goes, "It's been bad because of the rain." I go, "Well, it's about to get busy." "Well, I don't see nobody." I go, "No, you don't get it. I'm here. You don't get it. I just walked in. And the blessing walked in with me." You watch God move. The car started piling in. You know what she said? "Where are you going to preach next? I want to come hear you preach." That's what the blessing will do.
It'll cause people to say, I want what you have.
Yes.
How are going to people want the God you serve when you have nothing?
Come on.
But fear and doubt and unbelief. Well, but when you walk in victory, come on now.
Yes,
man, I preached Thursday night in a predominantly white church. There was a couple of Raza there. There's one guy followed me out. I don't know, man. You talk about it. Cucarachas in his shoes or something, but he was dancing. Brokenly, oh, Pastor, it was good tonight. Come on now. Oh, Holy Ghost, come on now. He was all excited. Oh, Brother Paul, and I knew he wanted to speak first. Said, Brother, poder de Dios, come on now. He goes, hallelujah, hay poder, brother. Tenemos la victoria, hallelujah. Why are we tripping, man? We're blessed, we're blessed, we're blessed. I'm trying to hit my car, almost broke my windshield. We're blessed. We don't know it. You'll never need anything after tonight.
Amen.
Never again. Never again. All you're going to have to do is ask and it's going to come.
Yes.
You ain't hearing me. Ask and it's going to come.
Yes.
Let me close. Number 6, 22 through 27. When you get home, if you can, write that down. Highlight it. Because this is your blessing. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto Aaron and unto his sons, on this wise you shall bless the children of Israel, saying unto them, the Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. And he shall put my name upon the children of Israel, and I will bless them.
Yes.
And I will bless them. We're going to pronounce that blessing over every family tonight. And listen, what's going to happen? We're going to say, the Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. Come on now. The Lord be gracious unto you. I mean, we need his grace every moment. The Lord be gracious unto you. He's going to lift his face upon you. Another translation says he's going to smile upon you. He's going to give you peace. When you go through the storm, you won't be moved. You won't say, if God be for me, who can be against me? Yeah, it'll get hard, but your faith will get harder.
Amen.
And your faith will get stronger. And you will determine and you'll say, I will not be moved. Because I am like a tree planted by many waters. And I shall not be moved. The blessing. In 1 Chronicles 4:10. We find the story of Jabez. Only two scriptures in the entire Bible given to him. And it says that when he was born, that his mother has so much sorrow that she named him sorrow. She named him pain. And if you study that, you understand that it was way deeper than childbirth. We know that man and woman were cursed because of the fall, and the woman was cursed with pain at childbirth. But it was beyond that, because we know that the names had significance. Moses meant being drawn out of. He was drawn out of the river. Ichabod means the glory of the God has departed. So the names had significance. So when she named him sorrow, there was something greater there. Doesn't mention the husband or the daughters. Don't know if the husband was murdered. The daughters were murdered as well. Mentions only him and his brothers. And the Bible says, and Jabez called the God of Israel, saying, oh, that thou would bless me indeed. Now listen, there's wisdom. He didn't, see, someone told him, you don't need the blessings, brother. You need to be blessed. Because if God blesses you, he's going to give you the power to be fruitful, going to give you the power to multiply, going to give you the power to replenish, going to give you the power to subdue, going to give you the power to have domination. Someone told him, if you cry out to God and ask him to bless you, he'll bless you. But he took it to the next step and he said, I don't want to just be blessed, I want you to bless me indeed. Indeed means with an unusual blessing. An amazing blessing. Something that will take your breath away. Come on. Something that will blow your mind and everybody's mind and say, how did that happen? He said, bless me indeed. Enlarge my coast. Or give me increase. That you might be with me. And that you would keep me from evil. And you know what he closes with? That it might not grieve me. I don't want any more pain. My mom named me pain. I want you to change that. I don't want any more pain. I want to be blessed. You know what the Bible says? And God granted him that which he requested. Some of you, you've been saved. And even though you fasted and prayed these 21 days, there's still some pain in you tonight. And only you know why you're hanging on to it. You have no reason. You have no excuse to be hurting anymore when there's a God that can heal you tonight. So tonight, we're going to bow our heads all across the building. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Maybe you're here tonight and you're not saved. Maybe someone invited you and you got a flyer. But if you're here tonight and you're not right with God, simply put, and if the Lord was to come tonight, you'd get left behind. If you're not sure that you're ready for heaven, but you want to be sure, lift your hand real high. We want to pray with you tonight. I see that hand. You can put it down. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? We're going to wait for you. Anybody else? Anybody else? Praise the Lord. Somebody give God a praise for this one soul. My Bible says heaven rejoices over one soul. Let's rejoice tonight. Let's all stand. You raise your hand. Come meet me at this altar. Somebody bring her. Give me a woman of God to pray with her, to lead her to Christ. In Jesus' name. They're going to pray with you, honey. I want you just to close your eyes real quick. Before we open the altars, under the anointing of God tonight, and the authority of the Most High God as a priest of God, and by the direction of the Holy Spirit, I bless this church in Jesus' name. I bless this church that the blessing of God might come upon every family represented right now. Lift your hands and begin to say, I receive it. I receive it. I receive it. Father, I pronounce your blessing. Not your blessing, but your blessing. The power to be fruitful. The power to multiply. The power, God, hallelujah, to subdue. The power, God, to continue to replenish. And the power, Lord God, to dominate in the name of Jesus. We pronounce this blessing now upon this ministry. We pronounce your blessing upon Pastor and his wife and her children's children. And Father, we ask that the blessing of God will bring an explosion to this ministry. That we would see the suddenlies hit in Jesus' name. We would see the sudden move of God, and we would see revival in this place like never before. We come now in faith. We ask you to help us at this altar tonight. When you're ready, come. The altar's open. Come. Come, begin to pour your heart out to God. I was blessed to listen to the sermon your pastor preached. The veil has been torn. The veil has been torn. We can come now into the holies of holies. Come tonight. Lift your hands. Begin to cry out and ask God to bless you. Tell him, Lord, bless me. Bless my family. Father, bless my children. Bless my grandchildren, God. May everything I touch prosper in the name of Jesus. Shandala Maporia. Come on, speak in your heavenly language tonight if you can.